authority, Mark Mendelson. May I have your attention? Yes. Mark has served since September 2001 as president of the Nine West Apparel, adding Jones New York collection in April of 2002. In October 2003, Mark assumed responsibility for Anne Klein, which Jones Apparel Group acquired through the purchase of Casper ASL LTD. In 2005, Mark was promoted to Chief Merchandising Officer for all Better Apparel brands of Jones Apparel Group. That's after graduating from SUNY Albany with a dual major, Economics Psychology, Mark started his career as part of Macy's Executive Training Program. This began Mark's journey over 20 years of experience in the sportswear business, both in retail and wholesale. Through the program, he became the sales manager of Macy's East. This led to his role as assistant buyer, then buyer for Bonwit Teller. In June 87, Mark became DMM and then GMM for Ann Taylor. After 6 years with Ann, Mark accepted the role as sales marketing executive vice president for Leon Max and later for Laundry by Shelley Siegel. August 1998, he accepted the position of president of Eli Tahari. He stayed with the company 3 years before joining the Jones Apparel Group. And now I would love to turn over the podium to my a man I respect so much.
Thank you. Thank you. It's kind of, you listen to your history. Do I need the speaker? Or do I need this thing? So you listen to your history, you're like, damn, I'm old. I think it's almost 30 years now.
Mark,
yeah, no, but I think I'm okay. I don't think I need it.
No?
Nope. So are you guys all, what are you guys majoring in here? Merchandising, okay, right. Fashion merchandising. And we have design too? How many of you want to be designers? Ooh, a lot. Okay. Okay, that's good. All right, so this is the deal. I have all of design reporting to me. So I, for Jones Apparel Group, is about a $5 billion company. And as of last, a year ago, December, I have 8 sportswear divisions reporting to me and 6, I picked up dresses in Thanksgiving. So I have 6 dress brands reporting to me. So basically, between dresses and sportswear, there's 14 different brands that I manage. And we're in market anywhere from 4 to 6 times a year. So pretty much always in market and pretty much always looking at clothes. I could tell you I've approved colors through spring of 2008 and have a pretty good idea. You really can't do, we do a season at a time. You really can't do colors for spring 2008 without liking what you did for holiday 2007, without kind of having an idea what you're going for summer 2008. So I kind of am juggling a lot of different seasons at the same time. I've done this kind of presentation. This looks like a pretty lively away group. I've done this presentation a few times for, I call her Alice, I can't pronounce her last name. But I've done this a few times for you guys, and we have it kind of set, and we'll do it, but I will tell you that it'll be more interesting for you guys if you ask me questions. So I have models, I'm going to tell you what we're doing, but it goes a lot better if somebody has the guts to ask some questions, because then I go into all different tracks. So you ask, how do I manage 8 different sportswear brands? Well, the way that you manage 8 different designers' teams of sportswear brands is you have muses, and you're very clear as merchants, those of you that want to be merchandisers, of who your brands represent. So what you do, whether you're design or you're merchandising, is as a designer you like to design. But if you design, let's say you design for Paris Hilton, but your clothes go to Kmart. Well, there might be a disconnect because Paris ain't shopping in Kmart. So you have to design what you believe in designing for, but then it has to get merchandised and sold in the right place. So there isn't one piece of the business. Designers can be fabulous designers. Mark Jacobs is amazing. If he didn't have Robert Duffy as his partner to help merchandise and kind of put it where it needs to be. So it's sort of like behind every great man is a woman. Behind every great designer is a great merchandiser. So I don't know what they call merchandising here, but for me it's all about you want your designers to be creative, and you pretty much want them to be even in La La Land and Fantasy Land, but then merchandising kind of brings them back to reality. So those of you that want to be designers, raise your hands again. Like, what do you want to design? You want to do everything? But no, it's not possible to do everything, and you're setting yourself up to fail if you want to do everything. So that's, see, this is good, we're already getting off on a tangent. You should do what you're really good at, and you should get people around you to do what you're not really good at. So for example, I used to be in charge of the career brands at Jones. I had Nine West, Jones, and Anne Klein. And somebody else was in charge of the casual brands, Jones Signature, Jones Sport, Easy Spirit, Jones Country. I'm really bad with the money, because I want to give the stores everything to make them happy. So what they did by making me chief merchandise officer is I have no bottom line responsibility. I play with design all day long, and somebody else does the numbers. So there's somebody else. Now, I can do the numbers, but there's somebody else that's really good at the numbers, and she gets all excited adding up markdown money and figuring out how much money we owe the stores. My answer is, if I sell you the right product, and my designers do a good job, and it's merchandised properly, and you still can't sell it, then it's your own problem. So they took me away from the money. So, for example, there's a woman in planning that works with me named Olivia. Olivia balances her checkbook to the penny. I've never balanced a checkbook my entire life. I have no idea how much money I have in the bank. I have overdraft. Hopefully it works. So, no, you definitely don't want to do everything. You want to do what you're really good at, and you want to surround yourself with people that are good at what you're not good at. So anyway, give me another designer that's willing to talk. Okay. So what do you want to design? So you want to focus on shoes. So do you want to focus on shoes for yourself? Do you want to focus, like, what shoes do you want to focus on? Okay. So who do you want to sell? Like, what stores do you want to sell? So not to bash your poor little hopes right now, but you can't, you got to be, and it's okay because you're in college, but I said I had 12 students from another class in my office today. You need to do some interning before you graduate. The saddest thing for me is to have somebody graduate 4 years of college, be sitting across the desk from me and go, so the thing is, and listen, I think you should be a designer, but Betsy Johnson is one price point. Saks doesn't carry a shoe that's under $300. So the point of this is, you should be able to design the way you want to design, but you need a strong merchandiser and a strong salesperson to kind of work with you. Do y'all kind of see that? She wants to design for 20-year-olds. She likes Betsy Johnson. She likes Young and Funky, but she wants to sell Saks. Well, Saks doesn't sell shoes under $300. And Saks is a customer. The average age of the customer that walks in the door at Saks is 52 years old. So do you understand that there's a lot you need to know? I'm not trying to scare you or discourage you, but you need to put people around you that know what you don't know. And when it comes, like I said, I want my designers to sit and sketch and be creative, but then what my job is to kind of put it into reality so it can make money. So if I design, if I let you design for 20-year-olds in cute shoes that you like, and they were $99 or $150, and we thought we were going to sell Saks, they wouldn't let us in the door. So, and then if I said to you, for the price point and the look you're designing, we can only sell the Limited, or Express, or BB, and then because of that, you have to use, you can't use leather, you have to use vinyl, but you can make it look like leather. You see, those are all the sorts of things that are going to happen. So that's kind of what, in my mind, the merchandiser does. So anyway, so what I do is, first thing is you analyze, where am I selling the clothes? So Jones does $5 billion. The sportswear that I'm in charge of does about $1 billion worth of shipping. So we ship about $1 billion worth of product, of which almost all of it goes to department stores. So the first thing you have to say to yourself, again, if we go back to the person that was brave enough to talk, so that I'm going to pick on the whole night, the department store customer doesn't walk into a Betsy Johnson store, because a specialty store customer that likes a little boutique is not the same customer that likes a department store. I sell department stores. That means no service, no ambiance,
come into your shop in the non-wet shoe stores. If I put the clothes in there, all of a sudden I have a different audience. But if I take the clothes from Macy's that I put a Nine West label on and I just stick them in the Nine West shoe store, do you understand the disconnect? Because only one of you in the whole room wants to go to Macy's to buy my clothes. So I'm obviously dealing, since I do $150 million in Nine West in business, I'm obviously selling somebody, but it's none of you. So if my clothes, if you were attracted by the clothes that I have, if you could fit into the clothes I have, if you wanted to spend money on the clothes I have, I'm in the wrong place. So understand that immediately by knowing that I'm coming to Nine West and I'm doing the clothing, but I'm not selling the shoe stores, I pretty much eliminated all of you in the room. So I had to position the brand to be something else, which is what we'll talk about when the models come out. So that was good. You all see what the issue is here. So again, we're talking merchandising because I may want you all to see a lot of brands don't do well. I'll just mention something like Kenneth Cole, who put his clothes up against my Nine West clothes in the department stores. They fit you, but you don't shop there. So the woman that wanted to try on the clothes that was in the Kenneth Cole department of Macy's couldn't fit into the clothes. The armholes were too tight or too high. The bust was too small. The pants were too low. He wanted to sell you because Kenneth wants to dress you because y'all are young and cute. But he wanted the volume because the money is on the third floor of Macy's. So there was a big disconnect, and basically he's on his third set of backers and licensing for his women's line because his mind and his ego wants to dress you, but he's putting his clothes for the big bucks for $100 or $200 million in a place you don't shop. Disconnect. DKNY City. Disconnect. Gone. H. Hilfiger. Disconnect. Gone. Now, the department stores would desperately like to get you into their store, INC. Do any of you shop INC? I don't even get some INCs in here. Okay, so I got a few INCs. But basically, you don't want to shop in a department store. That's okay. We know that. So you can be sure that the department stores are trying desperately to get you in. Basically, they get you when you're younger with your mommy and your daddy and their charge card, and then they lose you, and then what happens is, and I say this all the time, I hope you get married to have a kid, but you can have a kid without getting married. But ideally, when you get married, have a kid, get a job, and you're working 5 days a week or 6 days a week or 70 hours a week, and you get dressed in the dark so that you don't wake anybody up, and you get on the train in the morning because you had to move out of the city to be able to afford to live with your kids and your husband. And so your time is limited. That's when you go back to the department store. Because that's when on Saturday, for the 2 hours that the kid doesn't melt down while he's with you, or the husband's taking care of the kid, you can run into Macy's, shop for the kid, shop for the house, shop for yourself, shop for the husband, and it's one-stop shopping. You no longer have time to shop a mall. So my department store customer, by the nature of the fact that she's in a department store, it's one-stop shopping. So immediately, every piece of clothing that I design for any, that my people design, that I merchandise for the department stores, no time. No time, no service. So all those fabulous wrap dresses from Diane von Furstenberg that you need instructions or a salesperson to help you put on, they don't work. If I do a wrap dress in any of my brands, they're completely fake because this woman gets dressed in the dark so she doesn't wake anybody up. She has 5 minutes to get dressed. There's nobody to help her when she's shopping in the store, and she has no time to fuss with it. So the fabulous Diane von Furstenberg dress that you can get help at Intermix, or you can go to the Diane store and get help, and the salesperson can show you how to be fabulous about it, that's not my customer. So the fact that I sell a department store, if it's not easy, if she has to think, if she has to spend more than 5 minutes figuring it out, I lost the sale. If it doesn't easily, if a print, like will you stand up for just a second for me? So this beautiful dress has no real black or brown in it. My customer doesn't have a shoe or a bag. My customer has a pair of black shoes and a pair of brown shoes. If it doesn't, thank you. Now, in the summer when she's starting to wear strappy leather sandals, I get a break there, I might have a prayer. But you'll see in my brands, if the prints don't have obviously black or brown in them, this woman doesn't have time to change her shoes or her handbag. Also understand if she's in a department store, she's probably not the most fashion-forward customer you ever dealt with. So not only does she not have time, she may not really care. Like you guys may rush home at night to get the new in style and to get the new Vogue. This woman rushes home at night maybe to get the new wine or Everything's going to be bra friendly. Do you now understand what happens as a merchandiser? So when I get some new designer in there who thinks miniskirts are the new trend, or short shorts are all over the runway, we set them straight really, really fast. And if they want to do short shorts, they can do those somewhere else. It's okay. You can all wear short shorts. They're not my lady. So what happens over a period of time is, my customer who has no time, isn't a fashion victim, she starts to understand that I'm doing these for her, and she starts to love my brands because they're talking to her. How many of you shop, if you like Betsy Johnson, do you like the clothes? So do you buy the clothes? Or would you buy the clothes if you have more money? Okay, so she's consistent. She is a brand and she has a look. So you like that look. She stayed focused and consistent on her brand. Well, that's what my job as a chief merchant officer is to keep the brand's position, keep the brand's integrity, and keep the brand's message very clear. So girls, come on out. So it's everything, it's not just the clothes. All at the same time. So philosophically, we broke the mold a little bit this year, but philosophically for 6 years, the Nine West model was Fernanda, and this is Jenny, but she looked like Fernanda. The Nine West model was Latin on purpose, and we went to a blonde this year, which was against my better judgment, but the Nine West brand was the first brand I did at Jones, and it's a cool mom. We positioned the brand to be a cool mom. So what happened is now you all have kids, your bodies have all gotten a little bumpy and lumpier, and psychologically, you have a kid. So there's no more Friday night, go out, get an outfit to wear Friday night to either get a man or be out with your friends. You already passed that. The kid's there, you got him on the hip or her on the hip, you got the job, and so all of a sudden you got my non-class customer is a career customer. She wants to be of the moment. She doesn't want to be trendy and throwaway. She's definitely curvy. So Jenny is a good model for us. Notice that if we do a jacket, there's detail here. Think about probably your older sisters who have had kids. All of a sudden, this part of her body isn't in the same kind of place. This part of her body, turn around me. This part of her body is good. If she's had a kid, she's not real happy with what's going on here, here, or here. This is a good part of her body. Notice that we do, you guys are all, you have a little t-shirt underneath. Like, a lot of you are interested in the layering. Judith, are you there? Judith, are you there? No, she's wearing a dress and she's got the little t-shirt on underneath. So you guys, you kids, are understanding the layering. My customer doesn't have time or want to deal with the layering, so we built it in for her. So she kind of gets the look. Again, my point over her head. As I said, the jacket has all the seaming and all the detail here to give her an illusion of a waist because she might have lost the waist. That's okay, I don't need her. And one more time, let's open up. She's getting that baby doll. We're giving her this baby doll look, but you notice that it's controlled. Because the one place she might have some shape is under the bust. So we don't want her to be sloppy and fly away. So turn around and look and see. Everything's controlled. So we're showing off this part of her body. The sleeves are sheer, but the body's lined. And so she's got the umpier look that's happening in trend, but it's not victim-y, it's not throwaway. And again, she's got the kids, so she's got to worry about the mortgage and the nanny and whatever. So if she pulls it out again next year, that'll be okay. We did gray, which was the new fashion color for spring, but it still goes back to black. You stand up here. So then we picked up Anne, and the DNA of Anne Klein is blonde. Now when I say blonde, her hair doesn't have to be blonde, but Anne Klein is blonde. So this is a Jennifer Lopez, Beyonce kind of curvy, definitely hoochie in your face, wants to be out of this girl, whose body may not be where she wants it. This woman is a wallflower. So Anne, and the other thing is, somebody asked me today, how do you know all this? Well, first of all, brands have DNA. Nine West has always been about fashion. So, you know what, I guess you could go change. Nine West has always been about fast fashion. So we have to be current here, but remember, I'm in a department store, so it's not you. So when we talk fashion, usually when we make a mistake at Nine West, we go too fast. Like, we have it out there before she's seen it on 500 other people. If I put a trend out there too fast, I don't do it at Nine West because she doesn't get it. She has to see it first. So now that she's seen all of you guys layering and putting the sleeves underneath and doing all that stuff, like, by next fall, she might get it. So then we have and. So anyway, when we go back to how do we know this, there's two ways you know this. Number one, we look at the selling every week. So every week, we put the selling up on the wall, best to worst. And everyone from sales to design to merchandising looks at, it's very simple. What went to the cash register? What did she buy and say yes to? What doesn't she like? And pretty much, if you keep looking at what she likes, she kind of tells you over and over again, I like this, I really hate this. So we picked up, we bought Anne. None of these lines did I start from scratch. So all of these had this selling that I'm telling you about. So when you see that Nine West sells everything that's kind of low cut, that kind of shows off her cleavage, that's kind of in your face and noticeable, you kind of get her personality. Well, Anne's personality, Anne Klein started her company in 69. Anne was petite. Her backers were Asian, Tommy Otake and Frank Mori. So the DNA of the Anne Klein brand is little, Asian. Now, if you think little and Asian, you don't think bold prints, you don't think bright colors, you think kind of quiet. And so, just for whatever reason, when you look at the things that work at Anne Klein, they're typically quiet. She's not trendy. Like, we still have not sold a walk short for work at Anne Klein. And with Mrs. Jones, we haven't gotten to yet, at Nine West, my customers are hourglass. They have, they're big here, they're big here. The one place they might have some shape is here. Anne is a pear. So Anne is a little bit flat-chested, and Anne is one size bigger on the bottom than on the top. So Anne's like this. So she's a 6'8", a 4'6". So if you know that, and we can tell this by the selling, but you can also see what's on the wall. So if you know that Anne's a little bit smaller on top, then all of a sudden, Anne doesn't mind being covered up. You would never cover up my Nine West girl in a jacket like this. You could never put this jacket on my Nine West girl because she doesn't want anything this covered up, this much, you know, this much like this, and this is the one part of her body she likes. Same thing with Mrs. Jones, she's just older. Anne is a little bit more, a little smaller on top, so we can sell four-pocket jackets. We can sell jackets that close like this. At Missy at Nine West, the jacket would be here, and this would be more of a Nine West or a Jones. You would never do this style. So again, guys, whether you're the designer or whether you're the merchandiser, if you get into this customer's head, you can get into what she wants. The fact that she's little means that chances are the sleeves are always going to be too long. So wherever possible, on an Anne Klein jacket, we do the slip so that she can walk right out the door without spending the money on the shortening. So these are all the little things. So they may not sound like they're a big deal, but if time after time she comes in and she goes, even if she doesn't know it consciously, if subconsciously she knows when she puts on Anne Klein, it doesn't have to be altered. The pants aren't too long. The sleeves aren't too long. When we do give her a print, they're typically kind of quiet. And they're typically kind of quiet and monotone. They're controlled. They're never that bold. They're kind of quiet. And so, and flat front pants. We sell 50% of our pants at Jones are pleated. Anne doesn't wear pleated pants. She doesn't need all that fabric. She's little. And then Mrs. Jones, which is the big, I would tell you, Anne Klein does about 100 million. Nine West does about 150 million. Jones does 350 million. So Jones does more business than those two added together. Mrs. Jones is my sub. Psychographically, Nine West, who I call Nikki, Nikki is 25 years old in her mind. Now, my mother's 67, and out of all the brands I do, she likes Nine West the best. So that's what I'm saying to you. In her mind, Nikki is 25. Anne is 35. Mrs. Jones is 45. Now, she could be 20 and a real estate agent, but she's an old 20. So Mrs. Jones is appropriate. Mrs. Jones is confident, successful. She's appropriate. Now, unfortunately, poor Holly isn't the size 12 or 14 that my average Mrs. Jones customer is, but the average sizes we sell at Jones are 10, 12, and 14. So this, as soon as you know that your average sizes are 10, 12, 14, you're not going to do a lot of light things on the bottom. You're not going to close her up here. Mrs. Jones likes her jewelry. Mrs. Jones wants clothes that are easy again, and she typically dresses up with jewelry. If you guys know a Mrs. Jones, the hair is perfect, the nails are perfect, the belt and the shoes and the bag match, like they're never sloppy, they don't leave the house without makeup, that's who Mrs. Jones is. So we give her, what we've done this year is their shine is a big trend, but we don't know that Mrs. Jones is going to understand gold and silver per day. So we took our twin set and we plated it with, if you come on up close, I don't know if you guys can see, but we plated it so it has a little bit of shine. There's a whole whole thing about volume, Balenciaga, Chloe. We gave Mrs. Jones volume, but we didn't give her any volume up at the top. There's no waist, and there's no, everything's here. So raise your hand if you want more fabric and bulk around your middle, ladies. So Mrs. Jones to 12 or 14, she definitely doesn't want bulk around her middle. So we give her an easy closure. The other thing that we find, okay, easy. The other thing that we find is Mrs. Jones is hot. Because if she's 45 to 50, she's hot. I won't go any further on that, or I'll get myself in more trouble than I usually do. So we definitely, now also, Holly, bend over. 6-inch neck drop. Passes the bend over the desk test. So whereas the Nine West top is allowed to be 7 to 7.5 inches, because she's definitely a little bit younger and a little bit more in your face, this one's got to be appropriate. She's a lawyer, she's a doctor, she's a professor, she's a teacher, she's a real estate agent. She has to be appropriate. She always has to be bra friendly. And she's going to be pretty and appropriate. Thank you. Will you let me know if anybody's changed? So, is everybody awake? I don't think I saw anybody asleep. Yes, good. Question. So I just gave you copious amounts of information of three of the brands I encourage us. Differentiate, because this young lady finds it a complete maze when she goes into the department store. How do we differentiate? How do we communicate all this information to the customer? Well, number one, as I said, if you do it over and over again, she kind of finds it. I would tell you that I have a job. There's over 100 people out in the stores that now report to me. That's another job I have that I didn't talk about. But the retail coordinators report to me. So I have over 100 people out in the stores that do nothing but go out and work the floors and make sure that we have specialists and salespeople. They do training seminars. And then on top of that, one of my other jobs is I'm a real estate agent. The reason that they gave me the job is because I'm the one that travels a lot, and I could probably draw you every mall. And if you walk into Macy's Herald Square, you'll see I have all the best real estate on the third floor. You can't, if you guys, when you get a chance, after today, you go walk the Macy's floor, other than Signature, which is stuck in the back, which I'm working on, other than Signature, Jones New York Signature, in Klein and Nine West, and Jones has the best real estate in the store. It's not necessarily that. Yeah, it has to do with the real estate. It depends on the store. It has to do with the real estate. Certain times, if you're right in front, it's too fast. Think of when you walk into a store, the thing that's right in the front door is too fast. I will tell you, it's really good that you ask this question. Very simple. In a mall, Nine West can be on the mall door. I would rather kill myself than put Mrs. Jones on the mall door. Mrs. Jones doesn't walk a mall. She's 45 years old. She wants a fitting room and a salesperson. So for Jones, put me near the best parking lot door in the mall, because she can park her door. Mrs. Jones isn't shopping. Mrs. Jones is a 14 and doesn't fit into most of what they put in the department store, because most of the clothes in the department store, most designers want to dress you guys because you're young and fun. Nobody wants to dress Mrs. Jones. So she knows that it doesn't really matter what there is there. She can't buy any of it. So Mrs. Jones wants the parking lot door in the back corner so that I get a register in the fitting room. A register means there's a salesperson if there's a chance. And so location for Jones is by the best parking lot door. Location for Nine West is impulse, it's fashion, she's a little bit trendy, she could be in a mall door. And location for Ann Klein, believe it or not, is put in near Jones, not because it belongs with Jones, but because I have the best salespeople in the department stores at Jones, so if I have a prayer of getting them anybody to help poor Ann, I'm putting her near her. The best salespeople in the department stores are Jones and Laurel, my number one competition. So anything that needs sales help, I want to put near Jones, because then my salespeople will help them. The minute this goes into a Carson store in Pittsburgh, the minute that they don't put this near Jones, it's sitting in the middle of the floor with nobody helping it. The minute I put it with Jones, my Jones salespeople that kind of work for me or get bonused and spiffed if they sell my stuff, they take care of the inventory. So I guess what this all amounts to is, again, I don't want to discourage or scare you, but it's not just design, it's not just merchandising, and especially now. If you sell specialty stores where the owner comes in, buys your line, puts in the store, she's on the floor, she's working with her customers, she literally comes in and goes, I want a size 8 for Mary Lou, so I want that one in blue for Mary Lou. Like, that's a whole different animal. Again, I sell department stores. No help, no ambiance, amaze. I would tell you they're all working really hard to fix the experience because basically, at this point, once you get out of New York City, if you get no ambiance and no service, then you might as well go to Kohl's, Walmart, JCPenney, Sears, or Target. So they've realized that the only way they're going to survive as department stores is they have to fix the experience. So there are more salespeople, the stores do look better, and they have done a good job trying to figure out how to put the floors together. The issue is, and again, this is very impolitically correct, most people that run these stores are men in suits that really don't have any clue as to how women shop. So when they try to lay out a floor, if you're a man in a suit that does that, when you go to get clothes, you stand at Barney's or Saks, and Heidi comes out and measures you and does all your tailoring, and if you're lucky, either he or your wife or your girlfriend pick all the shirts and ties to go with it, you pretty much figure out. Your mother buys you the underwear and socks at Christmas. That's really not somebody that you want trying to figure out how a woman's going to shop with three kids, a handbag, an umbrella, you know. So, but overall, I would tell you, what's interesting is Lord Taylor's being run, our CEO's a woman, the number two person at Macy's, both number two women, people at Macy's are women. So I would tell you that they're all getting better because you have women that kind of understand the experience running these stores now. But it's not just design, and it's not just merchandise, it's real estate, it's salespeople, it's a lot of stuff. So our next delivery was March. And Jenny, again, you can see this whole, we wanted to give her the illusion of this deep V that you all are wearing some kind of lower top with some kind of layer. A lot of you are wearing with layering underneath it. I mean, you notice her neck drop is much lower. She probably wouldn't completely pass the bend over the desk test, but she's not probably working somewhere that she has to. And we give her a wide leg cuff pant, but can you let them see the top of this pant? The top, the waist. Clean, guys, always clean. Everything's very clean, everything has stretch. And most of the fabrics, this happens to be a novelty, but most of the fabrics we use at Northwest are fiber dyed. The fabric is fiber dyed as opposed to fabric dyed. So the yarn is dyed with the Lycra. There's a slight girdle effect and holding in effect to all my Northwest based pants. There's a Cindy pant and a Lisa pant. They'll take 10 pounds off of you. Now think of your sister that had the baby. My VP of sales that runs Northwest has been a 4. When she started at Northwest, she was a 4. She's had 3 kids. She has the Lisa and the Cindy pant. This is actually the Cindy. From 4 to 16, she owns the pant. And when she gets her biggest, she's in the 16, and as she loses weight after she loses a kid, when she gets back down to the 6, we know she's probably going to get pregnant again. And she's done on the 3rd. She's not done. So anyway, so this was our March delivery here. And just, again, guys, you've got the baby doll look or whatever the thing is that's happening. It's tracked back to black, so she knows what shoes and what to wear with it. It all goes back to her black bag, her black shoe, and she's all set. Ann, thanks honey. Ann is in a little speckled twin set. Again, we have Ann all covered up, but it's okay because Ann can be covered up. And Ann's kind of just pretty. Like Ann doesn't stand out. Ann's a wallflower. Ann doesn't, Northwest, when she walks in the room, everybody notices her because Nikki's got the personality and the nails and the jewelry, and Nikki is Nikki. When Ann walks in the room, she doesn't really want to be noticed. She's just kind of pretty. Pretty, she's pretty. And then we have Holly, we have another twin set. I don't know how you want to do all these twin sets. Anne likes, Mrs. Jones likes color. So again, Mrs. Jones is probably, is she Nikki's mother? Maybe not, I don't know if Nikki, maybe. But Mrs. Jones definitely likes color. She likes bright color, happy color. I would tell you for spring I didn't do enough color. This color blew out. How many of you would wear this color? Blew out, we should have put a lot more out there. Because we were a little scared of it too, Jolly Green Giant, Big Green Bean, and again, flat, and actually, Mrs. Jones, real estate agent, travels a lot. This is knit. This was new for Mrs. Jones. The skirt that Holly had on before was silk, and it wrinkled. It doesn't wrinkle a lot, but Mrs. Jones doesn't like to be wrinkled. This is something new that we did. This is a t-shirt pattern. Now we doubled it, so because, you know, we don't want her sheer. We don't want her naked, but this is the first first time. So what and what the response was here was, again, we played in the yard. Come on up close. What started to happen here, guys, was as I was going out to the stores talking to the customers, I got a lot of, okay, I have a wedding. Like, I'll give you an example. My sister's bas mitzvah was 2 weeks ago. Well, there was a Friday night rehearsal, the Friday night dinner for the out-of-town people, the outfit that you wore to the synagogue, the outfit that you wore to the party Saturday night, and then the outfit that you wore Sunday morning. So I'm not necessarily dressing her for her daughter's event or for the wedding. I'm not dressing her for her kid's wedding, but I could be dressing her for the rehearsal dinner and the bridesmaids brunch. So all these kind of things that don't wrinkle, that are a little bit dressier because they have a little bit of shine in them, these are all the kind of things that Mrs. Jones took with her on these trips that she packs in her suitcase. And while we don't typically do tons of elastic, this isn't an ugly, nasty elastic. So again, if she's at an event for the weekend and she partied too much Saturday night, she doesn't have to squeeze herself into this. Think about what your pants are like the next morning on Sunday. So we found, thanks, Holly. We found that Mrs. Jones definitely was looking for, I call it event clothing. It's not special occasion, but it's an event. She has something around another occasion. So you'll see that Mrs. Jones, based on being 45 and knowing what her income and her life is all about, she'll spend money. She could wear the same tired black suit to work every day, but she'll spend money on that. If she's going to be seen with all her relatives and friends and family Friday night, Saturday morning, Sunday morning, she wants event dressing.
Yes.
So the question was, do we sell online? We really suck online as a company. It's one of the biggest initiatives we have for next year. And one of the reasons is we have a lot of outlet stores. So it's really hard. If I ship the outlet store 4 weeks after I ship the department store, what price do I put online? That's one of the excuses. I would tell you we're just really behind. The Neiman Marcus website does more business than any one of their stores. It's going to do somewhere around $400 or $500 million. We don't do a good job. I will tell you what we're starting to do as a stopgap is we're partnering with Macy's and Nordstrom. Like Juicy didn't want to put together their own website, but they partnered with Neiman's so that when you go to Juicy, it kind of brings you to a Neiman's website. So we're going to partner Jones with Macy's and probably Non-West with Nordstrom so that while we won't have our own website, I mean, we have websites, but they're not geared to the clothes. You can go on there and see what the clothes look like, but we're not anywhere near where we should be on the website. So my partner owns a company called Vince, and he's on the website every morning. He looks at Shopop and Saks and Neiman's, and he absolutely looks to see what sizes he sells. Shopop is his favorite place. He ships them 12 pieces. You can see in 2 days. You never heard of Shopop? Shopop.com. I think Amazon bought them. But Shopop is his favorite online place for looking at his sizes and what's selling, and yes, you absolutely, the internet is an amazing thing if you get yourself together to figure out how to do it. So our last change, so now we're April, and the weather's changed. If you think about it, February and March, it's snowy, it's nasty, we're a little covered up. Now we're summer, April's summer, like it's 80, and so we got a little jazzier, but we're still going to work. So, we've got a little, this sweater we've sold in about 6 colors, it's doing really well. We knew that the uniform, we figured that by April, Nikki would understand the layering and the bi-level. We put a belt on the shirt, but see the little string? This isn't to save money, this is so she can cut it off, because again, if Nikki's waist is a little thick, number one, they love these belts because they think they're getting some for free, which they are, because they don't charge more for the belts. But everything's fit to look fine without the belt too. So everything in Nine West has stretch in it. And again, notice the shape. Turn around, honey. These are samples, obviously, but notice the shape. And again, turn around. The buttons stop here. We never button Nikki up. No, never. And if we ever, and the reason I say never is, I get a designer. One day they'll feel I'm into menswear shirts. Okay, I let them put one on the line. Inevitably, when we don't do what Nikki wants, it winds up on that bad side of the wall. So remember I told you, we put the selling up every week, best to worst. Inevitably, invariably, the things that aren't Nikki wind up on the worst selling. So, you know, you let a designer do a couple of things. Like if they wanted to do a short, at this point I would tell you, I wouldn't let them do a short. But But in the beginning, when I let him do a short, short maybe, when it winds up on the crappy end of the wall, and I love this shirt, I don't even remember this shirt. It's cute. Again, guys, I typically don't do any waist. I don't want to do, when you don't do a waist, if she wants to wear it low, again, I have no sales help in these stores. So if you do no waist on all your bottoms, if she wants to wear it at her belly button, she buys the 4. If she wants to wear it below her belly button, she buys the 6. If she wants, you know, so there's an advantage when you're doing that. So these are all little subtle things. Thanks, Jennifer. And now here, Anne, we jazz her up a little bit. We did give her the low, low neck. This is built in, guys. This is one piece. And this sample's obviously very big on Lisa. But this is all built in. So we gave her this look for April. Again, we gave her a knit skirt. This is Matt Jersey. So we moved all these ladies into knitwear pretty much. Jenny's lace skirt was knit. Jenny, you have to come back out and get a clap eventually. Stay here. And then Holly also has on a knit skirt print and a little bit of jazz because we're April, it's summery, we want to be a little bit more, you know, the jacket's going away and we're going to be a little bit more festive and happy. We gave her a little belt that can come off. So actually, she can take this belt. She can wear it on her tunic. And notice, turn sideways, Holly. As we get longer, we slit the sides because, again, we know that this woman's a 12 or 14. So now think about it, guys. We know this woman's a 12 or 14. Chances are this is the part of her body that's not pretty. So we put your eye up here. She's a 12 or 14. It doesn't matter up here. And we put all the movement down here. We pretty much kept you not looking here. That's not an accident. All right, where'd Jenny go? Should we come back out? Grab Jenny, and we'll let them give you guys a hand. Because I think I'm done with time. I'm done with the one of the day. Guys, more questions?
Hunger.